I grew up in a small city in the Central Valley of Central Chile, pretty much right between the mountains and the ocean. And even though I could only see the mountains and my house, I fell in love with the ocean at a very early age. I was mostly in the beginning vacationing with my family, every summer spending time at the ocean. But there was one person that really changed my life. That was Captain Jacques Cousteau. He was a French documentarist and scientist who had these beautiful documentaries back in the 70s and 80s, telling us everything about the ocean. Well, there was one particular episode, and to be more specific, one particular image that really literally changed my life. That was an image that looks a little bit like this. It's basically a drop of seawater magnified and seen under a microscope, showing all the beauty and the life, the microbial life that exists. And just realizing how much life and how beautiful it is in this single drop of seawater was really mind-blowing to me. Then realizing and learning more, you know, that about 70% of our planet is covered by water, and realizing how much of our planet is actually covered by this microbial life, it just really changed my life again. And it really made me feel like I had to study this in the future, and I became first a marine biologist and then an oceanographer. So, something that I didn't know back then, though, was what these microorganisms do in our planet and the important role that they play. They are a source of life. They are basically photosynthesizing. These are microalgae living at the surface of the ocean and the sand-lit part of the ocean. So they play the same role that plants do on land. And by photosynthesizing, they are basically producing oxygen. So most of the oxygen that we breathe actually comes from these microorganisms. They're also fixing carbon from the atmosphere doing photosynthesis. So they're actually interacting directly with our climate system by pumping down CO2 from the atmosphere, a powerful greenhouse gas. Another thing that these organisms do, they sit at the bottom of food webs in the ocean. So they feed small, tiny animals known as zooplankton that feed small fish, that feed larger fish, that feed larger predators, all the way up to humans. So all the animal protein that we enjoy from the ocean is actually feeding on these tiny microbes. Another thing that we know, and I really want you to keep with you and take home today, that no matter where we are, no matter how far from the ocean we are, our daily actions have an impact on the ocean. So I hope I will get back to this message later. So one of the things that you're probably most familiar with is things like pollution. And marine pollution, you know, you've seen all pictures like plastics becoming a serious issue today. There's also pollution that we get through rivers and, you know, all the nutrients that we use for agricultural practices that end up in the ocean at some point. Well, we all know that pollution threatens life, but not only big life, like with the one we see in this picture, also these microbes that I've been talking about and all kinds of life on our planet. So let me take you through, you know, a small journey about other changes in the environment that are also impacting life. I'm sure most of you have seen a figure like this before, where we've seen that ever since the Industrial Revolution, ever since humans started burning fossil fuels very actively, we've been adding extra carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. And over the last century, that amount of carbon dioxide has increased dramatically fast. Since carbon dioxide is a powerful greenhouse gas, which means it traps heat in the atmosphere, our planet has been warming along. So ever since the beginning of the times when we started measuring these, the planet has warmed up for more than a degree Celsius. A lot of this extra heat that we have in the ocean has been, in the world, has been absorbed by the ocean. So about 90% of that extra heat has been absorbed by the ocean. So the ocean globally is warming up, and that's a big stressor for life. So this is changing their habitat, the distribution, and so on. Another consequence of this warming is that the ocean is losing oxygen. So why? Because warmer waters hold less oxygen than cold waters. And also because as the upper layers of the ocean warm up, they have a much harder time mixing with the deeper layers of the ocean. And therefore, the ocean has a much harder time mixing and ventilating. And since we know that most forms of life on our planet rely on oxygen, this is obviously a serious problem. And this lack of oxygen, or this expansion of these zones with very low oxygen, is impacting life, including those natural resources that we rely on. An additional complication is that this additional carbon that we're pumping into the atmosphere is being absorbed by the ocean. About a quarter of the CO2 emissions every year are being absorbed by the ocean. So this is changing ocean chemistry, and it's impacting organisms such as corals and through a process known as ocean acidification. So you might be wondering, now telling you the story about these little microbes, what's happening to them? What are they doing? Are they responding? Are they adapting to this change? And how are they adapting? So the response to this question actually is a little bit simpler than what you can imagine. And it's rooted in something as simple as the chemistry of different fats, fats like the ones that we have, like fatty acids and cholesterol. Well, if we look at the chemistry of two different fats, such as butter and olive oil, we see that fats like butter contain these fatty acids that have these straight change tails known as saturated fatty acids, whereas olive oil contains fat that look more like the one on the other side that has these crooked tails known as unsaturated fatty acids. Well, these different fats have different properties, and if you try to pack some of these fats, especially at different temperatures, you will see that those straight tails will pack more closely together compared to those that are more crooked. And this is one of the reasons why if you put butter in the fridge overnight and you take it out in the morning and try to spread it on your toast, it's going to be really hard. So organisms can actually take advantage of the changes or the properties of different fats under different environmental stressors. So if we were to look at a single cell organism, and if we were to zoom into its cell membrane, we can look at those fats there, and these organisms can change the chemistry of the fats that they contain in their cell membranes in response to environmental stressors. This is a physiological response to stress because of temperature, oxygen, pH, and so on. This is important because it gives us chemical clues about how organisms are responding and adapting today and potentially in the future. So you might be wondering, how can we study the secret stories of these microorganisms and how they're adapting to a changing environment? So I'm very fortunate to lead the organic geochemistry group here at the University of Colorado Boulder, with a diverse group of researchers studying the chemical signatures of life in our planet today and also in the past over geological timescales. And many of us have a strong focus in the ocean. So one of the things we do, we spend time at sea. We go out on oceanographic vessels, like the ones in this picture, where we deploy certain instruments in the water, where we can collect large volumes of seawater from multiple layers of the ocean, that we can filter, we can trap those microorganisms, we can freeze those samples, take them to the lab, and apply a whole bunch of different techniques in chemistry to extract those chemical signatures. We can also do some experimental work. We can go out at sea and now deploy these large containers known as mesocosm experiments that allow us to basically manipulate the environment under which certain microorganisms are living. We can alter the chemistry, we can change the temperature of these systems, and we can follow the evolution of these ecosystems over time and trace how organisms are adapting. Again, we filter that water. That's a big deal in oceanography. We filter a lot of water. We bring it to the lab and study the chemistry. The long-term goal of our group and collaborators and people in my field is to start looking at life in the ocean from a chemical perspective, where we can study different kinds of ecosystems and different microbes around the world, and we can look at their unique signatures, chemical signatures, that at some point would allow us to trace a specific or link a particular fat to a particular biological source, but also to understand how organisms are adapting to the changes that are happening today and to those changes that are expected to happen in the future, depending on what we decide to do today in terms of carbon emissions for the future. So I hope I have convinced you that this microbial life is important, plays an important role, and that you care about it. So if you're wondering about what you can do, one of the first things you can do is to reduce your carbon footprint. You know, eliminate fossil fuels and rely on clean sources of energy. Educate yourselves and all on those of around you about the importance of climate change and the consequences to life and to us. You know, advocate for changes in policy that will bring a much brighter future and importantly, vote for people who would actually support that kind of legislation in Congress. I would like to go back now to wrap up to something I mentioned earlier. No matter where we live, no matter how far from the ocean we are, our daily decisions have an impact in the ocean and life in the ocean. So this beautiful picture shows the main watersheds in the United States with all rivers that you can find. The purple one shows the Mississippi River. The yellow one shows the Colorado River. And here in Colorado, a landlocked state, very far away from the ocean, our actions, our decisions today have an impact on, you know, because we are right by the Continental Divide, on watersheds that can influence different parts of the world's ocean. So no matter where we are, we always have an impact in the ocean. So keep that in mind. So I really hope that next time you think about what you're doing for the future of our planet and what you're doing to help coping with climate change and the consequence of climate change, you will remember the story of these tiny microbes living in the ocean that sustain most life in our planet. Thank you.